Hello and welcome to Strategic News International. I am Surya Gangadharan. A lot of the debate about 5G is about security and about indigenization. So one of the questions here is there a roadmap for indigenization in India? And I have with me Professor Kamakoti of IIT Chennai. He's also a member of the National Security Advisory Board. Professor Kamakoti, is there a roadmap for indigenization since you've been so closely involved with 5G for so many years?
There has been a big thrust on indigenization in the recent past. 5G basically comprises hardware and software. There are a lot of software development that has been happening long back, and that can continue and that will continue. In the area of hardware, which is the other aspect of it, there are two aspects to hardware design. One is the design, another is the manufacturing. There are very good design houses in the country, which basically can make hardware models which can be manufactured in fabs outside currently, because we don't have that level of strategic, that level of high-end fabs in the country. But over a period of time, we could bring it inside the country. So, in the area of software that is required for 5G, India has the potential and has the expertise to do the entire stack. Even in the case of 4G, there have been instances where the entire 4G stack has been made in India. The software for that. In the case of hardware, the designs can really be done in India. And only the manufacturing we have to go out temporarily. And if the government comes out with a fab, government helps, and it can be a private party partnership, or and we get a fab inside, then it can become indigenous. So this is the overall, what I can say as a overall point of view from which we talk about this roadmap, right? And so then we can elaborate on individual issues on this. If I want an indigenous roadmap for the country, we need to have a 5G. Specifically in the area of 5G that we are debating today. We need to have a 5G specific rollout model for India. And that rollout model basically should, consider having, removing the software and the hardware, or decoupling it, so that the software can be developed and the software can run on any commodity hardware.
Meaning any commercially available hardware?
Any commercially available.
From any country?
Right.
With no security issues?
No. So, suppose I have a hardware and I have a malice inside that, for it to manifest itself, there should be a software that is written to go and intricate it and get out.
Okay.
If the software is done by separate somebody and the hardware is done by somebody else, then it becomes quite difficult. At least it increases the difficulty level for an exploit. And that's the first guard that we need to do for security. So, that is one part. But then, the moment we remove the software and hardware. Now we are software giants. We have the best brains. We have been producing the best brains in software.
Yeah.
So one entire part of the 5G can be now becoming indigenous. Like our own companies can be encouraged to make the software, which can be deployed. And on the side of hardware, this hardware is now split into multiple things. Like there is something called end equipments, like your mobile phones now. Then there are some small cells. Then there are base stations, and then there's a core network. So now in small packets, so this is highly modularized.
Yeah.
And so we can start off with some modules in India and slowly keep percolating, building upon these modules. And that will be an excellent roadmap. And that is something which is very important. One of the biggest need today is we have a lot of designs in the country, a lot of IPs that are made in the hardware side. But unlike software, to prove that my IP works, I need to invest millions of dollars for fabricating, because I have to sow a silicon.
Yeah.
And that is also one-way ticket to the moon, right?
Yeah.
If you make a hardware and it doesn't work, what do you need to do? Go and throw it in the nearby, God bless. But if it is software, if there is a mistake, right?
It can be corrected.
I can correct it and sell it as the next version of it. Okay, I can make money out of it.
Yeah.
But that's a real problem with hardware. So, one of the things that we can also, the government can consider, is to encourage Indian startups by having something called this chip fund,
right? Yeah.
So where we can basically fund some of these commercially viable chips and basically, use them.
Has that started to happen?
It will happen. There are a lot of initiatives by the Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology on this chip manufacturing. So at least at the academia level, we have no process by which we are taping out chips. For example, IIT Madras, we have taped out many chips in the area of analog, the Shakti microprocessor that we have done.
Yeah.
It's all funded by IIT. So there is a platform that is available, and that has to be now extended to the startup industry. And there are startup funds that are coming. Specifically in this electronic sector, if you allow this startup fund, I think that will groom up very easily.
So why hasn't it taken off until now?
See, one thing is the market. Right? Today, now we have a big market. Like if 5G world shows, now we have a very big market of small devices.
Yeah.
See, mobile phone is not a small device. But there can be devices which are much lesser than a mobile phone also.
Mm-hmm.
So that is one thing. So now we have large amount of market and there is a government support also for that.
Mm-hmm.
And then we need this government support can be in terms of, say, if you indigenous content, we encourage indigenous content, indigenization. That's a very clear-cut policy. I think we are slowly coming towards that. So there are a lot of movement towards indigenization.
Yeah.
And once this type of a policy specifically on every sector right, is available, then the startups will have an assured market. And today, even if I have a startup company and I want a VC funding, now the VC funding will also depend upon the government policy. Because government will support them, so let us go and fund them.
Yeah, okay.
So it will also be very interesting to get that model. See, these are some of the things that I believe today, with the current the focus of the government and the current security issues also coming up on the
government.
I think this is a very crucial point that such decisions can enable us to take.
Mm-hmm. Given the fact that you have so many foreign players in the 5G market, you have Huawei, Samsung, Ericsson and so on. Are there any Indian companies that are presently in 5G?
See, there are in the area of software. I think any software giant today, we have many giants today. They run almost a lot of their international business, and then software, there is absolutely no issue that we can quickly take it up. On this area of hardware, there are a lot of very good startups. For example, I can tell you Tejas Networks. They have been doing large-scale network, Niveti systems in Bangalore, and then the signal chips. But the only thing that they need is this encouragement to make hardware and then deploy them, and then the support saying that, okay, somebody should tell them, if you do this with this acceptance criteria, I will buy, say, 1 million of it.
Okay.
The moment such an order comes, very clear cut, and the person who says will stick to that commitment. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Government can say to some extent, but then the private industry also should play a role and encourage this.
Mm-hmm.
In this case, telecom vendors, like Jio or Airtel, should say, okay, make this, I'll buy 100,000, I'll fund you, take it.
Mm-hmm.
That happens. The moment I have a purchase order from a committed the thing, and they keep to the commitment, I think that's the only thing, only hindrance today.
Mm-hmm.
We'll pick it up.
So, do you think there's a need now to perhaps go slow on 5G until we build up our internal domestic capacities?
Not necessarily. See, I told you, right, we have a rollout model in which you say that software, hardware should be different, and you give it to the telco. Essentially, one of the compliance should be that the fellow who is supplying software should not be running the hardware.
Yeah, okay.
Decouple this. So, security issue, many issues will get satisfied.
Yeah.
This is my feat, because after working in this area, I know that this is what one thing. But then, you also get what would be the use of 5G? That survey we need to do. Then only we'll understand the market also.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Today, if I say, okay, I'm getting something at, say, 1 megabit per second, I'll get it at 100 megabit second, so I'll download a movie fast. Entertainment is one thing. Entertainment is very important. So,
entertainment
is what we are using phones for.
Mm-hmm.
In addition to entertainment, do you have any pressing needs for 5G? We should make a survey. There are things today, and that we should make a survey on that, and then basically, that will drive our market also.
Mm-hmm.
So that's very, very important. And that, I think many so people who are pushing for 5G will actually have done the survey.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel that there is a need for it.
Mm-hmm. In the question of, in your view, a domestic, purely domestic driven 5G could be a little slower.
It also depends upon how well have we used the 4G today.
Okay, true.
Right.
Yeah.
So the domestic driven 5G will become attractive when, right? So that's the thing. So that is also something that we need to take off. And what would be the cost of that? So all these things depend upon how the market will adapt. See, if I'm going to get a HD on my mobile phone, And certainly I'll take it, but what would be the cost for it?
True, yeah.
So those are, all these factors are there.
So a purely domestic driven thing would be obviously much cheaper.
Should be cheaper, otherwise there'll be no money.
Yeah,
so I actually, there are three spectrums, like I have extreme broadband, is used for very high speed.
Mm.
And then there are the massive communication, and then very low latency requirements, which is a high reliability thing.
Mm-hmm.
That's the speed, there is mass communication, and then there is reliability. So there are three horizontals in this whole 5G communication. I think even one of them picks up, that's going to be big for us.
Mm-hmm.
For example, mass communication. Now I can increase my, now there are so much call drops and other things.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then, now the frequency by which I say network is busy, because the cell, the tower doesn't have more capacity to associate more terminals.
Yeah, yeah.
So that is increasing today. That means the density of mobile users is increasing.
Mm-hmm. The major question here is security. Does largely domestic driven 5G guarantee security?
No, domestic driven 5G should be guaranteed with security. That's the thing, right?
Okay.
Right. Only thing that is that we need to basically minimize the risk.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Minimize the risk and learn to live with vulnerabilities and put lot more control mechanisms to see that, you know, we control the whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
So these are the steps. And since it, see, the major issue of security comes because it's now becoming more and more domestic.
Yeah.
Right. And so we should not land up, like recently there was an attack in one city, Baltimore, where many computers stopped working in the morning and they were all ransomware, and then even reports say that there was money paid to basically get back, you know, to the hackers.
Uh-huh.
Right? So now this cryptocurrency and other thing gives you a very easy way of hiding and, you know, taking the money without even, you know, we don't know who is receiving the money.
Yeah.
And you can send them. So these are some of the bigger issues that come up.
Mm-hmm.
So domestic will drive 5G market. Of course, on the three verticals that I've been telling, the massive communication, which we are talking of, that's going to be the highest market. Absolutely, that's going to be the highest market. But that is the market where we need to also provide more security.
Now, there is a view that India has been watching and waiting others for 5G. And in that sense, we've done less groundwork. And ideally, we should be looking at 6G right now. Is that a practical thing?
No, we have to start looking at 6G. And that's very, very important. So the for probably 6G will be all bad lessons learned from 5G.
I see.
Right? Because that's always true.
Uh-huh.
Right? And at the same time, we can't say we are slow. But see, the first thing is that we need to understand what would be the use of 5G. I think that's happening. So suppose you ask a telecom vendor, will your 5G sell?
Hmm.
Now, will you have an answer?
Yeah.
No, if I open up a spectrum and nobody takes it, right? Or somebody takes it and they found very less use of it. Hmm. Then it's going to be useless. So we need to reach a stage where people are convinced of using 5G. People are, you know, and other conceptions about health, all these things are, you know, completely satisfied, removed, those type of serious concerns are addressed, if at all they exist, and you know, that type of mechanisms have to come, and then the market has to come. See, so suppose somebody introduces 5G today, is he sure of the market?
That is
something more important.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the only thing. So we can give trial spectrum and people can start trials and they can do whatever this.
Mm-hmm.
But finally, the success depends upon how well the country adopts. Finally, the common man has to buy a 5G phone.
You know, you mentioned trials. Now, I understand the 5G trials, equipment trials are beginning in sometime in September.
Okay.
Do you see any scope, any Indian equipment there? Or
I think there's a 5G testbed project that's happening. And then we do have some trials that are some trial hardware that will be there, and I think that will be part of the trials also.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure there will be some industries who will be participating in this.
Mm-hmm. So, last question. Uh-huh. Do you, in this entire 5G debate, what are the, do you see any pitfalls, any obstacles?
I don't see any pitfall or obstacles, but the only thing is that at every point we need to make a conscious decision, and that decision should be rational. And every time we take a decision, it will be very difficult to roll back because it's of the scale. See, I distribute some 10 phones and I get back the 10 phones is easy. I distribute million phones and get back million phones, it's not going to be easy.
Yeah.
So that's the only thing. So the scale is something that makes us more cautious, right? Say for example, 2G, 3G, 4G, nobody even know that.
Yeah, yeah.
3G to 4G transition, did anybody care? Nobody.
Yeah.
The reason is the scale. Today there's a scale. And then and it becomes very, very close to this thing. And people have started using, with Digital India and other things coming up, people are using these network equipments for different commercial needs. And
yeah, yeah.
When those things come up, the notion of security also comes up. And then, all the issues like denial of service, all that we are talking of in cybersecurity comes up in a big way.
Yeah.
And so every point that we take, we need to think and do the correct thing. So because reversal is very difficult because of scale.
On that note, Professor Kamakoti, thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you very much, Surya.